Hey, this is Adam Mervis, and you're watching Real Talk.
Adam, tell me about this film. For those that haven't seen or don't watch, I saw the trailer myself. I'm super hyped for it.
Good.
Tell me about the film for those that don't know a little about it. What can you expect? Because I'm expecting a lot of twists and turns and a lot of murder mystery.
If you've seen nothing, if you don't know anything, this is it's a ride. And you're going to get on a rocket ship and you're going to go. And yeah, it's going to turn a bunch of different directions. And you think you're going to know what's going to happen. And you're going to not have any idea what's going to happen. And hopefully for an hour and a half, an hour and 45 minutes, we can make you forget about everything else.
Tell me about the initial approach to this script. How did it come about? What was the starting process of it with the idea from its inception?
Yeah, unemployment.
That's the writer's world, right?
Yeah. No, I was doing theater, some theater in New York. And
you've done some acting too, right?
Yeah, I'm an actor as well, so I act, and then I was sort of sitting in New York in a sublet apartment with no real job, and I kind of just started, it sounds a little cliche, but I started kind of to go walk the streets in New York and start look for my next story, and I stumbled upon a couple characters that appear in this movie in real life, and there was then a famous robbery at the Maraschino Cherry Factory in Red Hook. And I took that robbery and thought of a couple of these characters who I met walk into this place unknowingly, what would happen? And then the hook of shutting down Manhattan, I don't know how that arrived to me, but that was just a big hook, and I was like, oh.
This is like an impossible task.
Can I curse?
Yeah, go ahead.
Oh, yeah? I said, oh, fuck. Like, that's a big movie. Like, if you shut down Manhattan, you know, on this chase, shit. You know? You got me excited.
And when you get this inception, this idea, you're kind of exploring, how does the first pitch go? Like, when you start putting it together, when you got the ideas and thoughts, what was the next step? Did you start writing at that point?
Yeah. I sit down, I lock my door, I had a big, in the apartment I was subletting, I had a big kitchen table, and I woke up every morning and wrote for about 6 or 7 hours, as long as I could, and then I would go back out into New York and look for something else, and then as I kind of was getting drafts, I was moving apartments, so I was carrying this script from apartment to apartment, and just I'd do another draft in another apartment and keep it going. And
how long was the whole process?
I started in July, and I think the Russo brothers emailed me that March, maybe, and were like, hey man, we really fucking love this script, let's do this thing. And I was like, great. So that was, well, how long was that? 6 months? Somewhere in there. Yeah.
It's not that long, you know, from an inception and all that.
Yeah.
I mean, you were working on it every day, so yes. You're putting in a lot of work to it.
Unemployment helps.
Well, one thing leads to another.
Here we are. We're doing okay. Yeah, exactly.
The journey leads
on to Real Talk right now, yeah.
There you go. You know, I was talking to the composer of the film, Alex Belcher, earlier today. And he was telling me about the story, how it helped him put the music together, score of the film, and how it was about the story, right, that guided it. When you're putting out a movie like this, especially when it's a mystery and it's kind of a whodunit, and you twist and turns, I'm guessing there's plenty of those.
Yeah.
How do you write that? I was curious about how you write a thriller, because the audience, especially if you're diverting the audience in many different directions, you don't want a movie that's like, oh, I figured it out from the start, right? The best movies with thrills are like, I didn't see this coming, holy shit, one of those things.
Yeah.
When you write these things, how do you approach the twists and turns and kind of fooling the audience in a sense so they don't catch on too early to it?
Yeah, I think when I'm finally sitting down and writing and not thinking about it, not doing anything other than writing, I'm trying to fool myself. So I'm sitting there.
If you were the audience member kind of thing, like,
I'm trying not to see it. You know, and the great thing about writing is you write it and you're like, ah, that's pretty obvious. You go back and you try to think of the least obvious thing. You know, I think like Christopher Nolan is probably great at that. Just the discipline to keep writing unusual things that go places that you don't know where they're going, you know?
So guessing throughout. That's
yeah, totally, yeah, you know, there's a great movie called Warrior. Do you remember the movie Warrior? And the end of that movie is Tom Hardy fighting Joel Edgerton and their brothers. And they get to the ring. And in the, as the audience, you're like, okay, this is a fight movie. Should be cliche. Like, someone should win. It should be really... They get to the ring, and you're like, I have no idea who's going to win this fight right now. And you're on the edge of your seat, because you're like, it could be one brother, it could be the other brother. And in a weird way...
It's the build to it, too.
Yes.
You know?
And it's trying to get to that place of, like, do you have no idea what's going to happen next? And then that's... As a person who loves going to the movies, I fucking love that, because I'm like, holy crap, I've seen 1,000 movies where I know exactly what's going to happen before I walk into the movie theater. And can it be the other way?
Yeah, the unpredictability. Yeah. What sort of movies are you attracted to? Are there any movies that you've been inspired on throughout your life that, you know, you try to even put in a little homage to this one? Is there anything that stands out that really inspired you in your writing career in that sense?
For this particular film, you know, I come from a family of cops in Miami, so I love the way cops talk. I love the gallows humor. I love that they're, you know, really funny guys, but who see a lot of really awful stuff. And the, you know, someone who does that great is someone like Richard Price, who wrote Clockers and has written for 100 shows. And I always loved what he does with dialogue and research and cops. You know, if we're talking about crime movies, I mean, Chinatown is a masterpiece, and that's sort of cliche, but something like The French Connection, even Conversations, which is earlier Hackman, you know, I kind of love those 70s thrillers, which this is kind of, and I also love, you know, Ridley Scott, kind of man on a mission, Denzel going out to eat lunch, and you're just like, fuck, let's do this. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So that's kind of what I went for.
When you wrote this movie, you know, writers sometimes have a person in mind after to play the lead role or some of the role that you're writing, any character in that sense. How did you approach that? Did you leave it kind of open-ended? I mean, obviously you got a guy like Chadwick Boseman who can do anything. He can play, I mean, historical figures and you know, such a wide range.
Yeah.
How was that with your writing process? Did you ever envision anyone playing this role, or you kind of left it open-ended so anyone could be able to handle it?
Yeah, I know a lot of writers sit down with an actor in mind when they write, just to help them write.
Right.
I that doesn't really work for me. I like to find the real person. So I kind of sat down to write this and wrote it as this guy Andre Davis. And you know, I think then as you start to kind of move through the machinations of rewriting with the director and the Russo brothers and all those guys, you start to kind of talk about, like, who would be right for this, and it just so happened that Black Panther had come out. To be honest with you, I knew who Chadwick was, but I didn't know who Chadwick was, and Black Panther had come out, like, about 6 months, I think, before I had finished the draft of this script, and I was like, when they said, like, we'd love to ask Chadwick, I was like, holy fuck. Like, yeah, let's do this, you know?
Especially at that time.
Yeah, at that time, I was like, yeah, sure, ask him, you know? And then when they came back pretty quick and said yes, I was like, okay, like, all right. I've been through the machine of getting a movie made a couple times, and it doesn't ever happen that fast, where the Russo brothers are emailing you, you know, Brian Kirk calls and says he wants to direct it, and then Chadwick Boseman says, yeah, I'll star in it.
Surreal stuff. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Like, I spent 6 months here bouncing around places, and here you have a Russo's on.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah, yeah.
That's crazy.
I was collecting unemployment in New York City in my underwear and wrote this movie, and then Chadwick Boseman is out 700 feet tall on the middle of Sunset and Vine, you know, so.
That's how life changes that quickly in this industry. It's unbelievable. You know, you're a living example of that in so many ways. And I wanted to ask you, what are some movies this year that you've seen that you really enjoyed the story of, or anything that kind of captivated you? I know Joker's a big talk, and that's like such a captivating movie in a sense like that. So I was going to ask you, if you've seen that movie in particular, what do you think of it, or any other movies that you also saw?
Okay, let's dish. Now we're going to get into it. I just saw Parasite today.
I've been hearing so much about that.
Yeah, it's good. I think... It's really good. The hype is high on it, so I want to keep the hype down, but everyone go see Parasite. It's very, very good. I really enjoy Jojo Rabbit, which is what he does in that movie, the balls on that guy, Taika Waititi, I mispronounced his name for sure, but the turn he makes, have you seen it?
Yeah.
I mean, the turn he makes in that movie, which is like a comedy, and then he turns it, and it works. That's a really hard thing to do.
And you're messing with a subject matter,
yes,
polarizing on the surface without people knowing about anything, to just know, like, whoa, it's a Hitler thing, you know, it's right away, it turns you off.
Yeah, you know you're going to make that movie, and the culture, the way it is now, 30% of the people are going to want to murder you. Like,
right.
Like, you're just going to hate you.
You're having negative feedback before even screening it, you know?
Yeah. And I saw Marriage Story the other night, which is very, very good. Yeah. It's like they don't make them like this anymore, Kramer versus Kramer, and it's a great little story. But Joker.
Yeah.
I love Joker. I mean, this is too inside baseball, but...
As a writer, you know, we've seen the different incarnations of Joker throughout the past.
Sure.
But this was different in a lot of ways.
Yeah.
I wanted to get it kind of from the writer's point of view, which, you know, how did it hit you?
It hit me again. I love kind of a movie. I'll forgive a lot of stuff that is authentic or, for lack of a better word, true to itself in a way, if that makes sense. You were talking about the old school, like, auteur theory. And that movie, I mean... The fucking balls on those guys. Fuck it.
Joaquin and Todd Phillips. I mean, they went for it.
Again, like the same kind of thing of like, let's just go and do this, and this is the way we want to make it. And I really appreciated that, and I thought it was, listen, Joaquin in that thing is phenomenal. Like stand back and just like get out of the way. But the execution of it was also phenomenal, down to the production design, down to everything. And you know, the inside baseball of it, that a studio like Warner Brothers had the guts to be like, go ahead and make that movie, is kind of awesome, actually. So,
it's something different, I felt, you know, that we haven't seen from that genre. And it's a character piece of someone who is not only Joaquin, but the city of Gotham. There's so many, you know, things are plucked away, too. We're talking about 70s movies. I mean, that thing is loaded with, like, your Taxi Driver and so many different things that you can connect that to. I just thought it was geniusly made, and there's so much talent. You know, that kind of brings me to a question. When you think of movies, how much input do you want to put in a movie from, like, society? You know, things that ring true what's going on around in real life that's facing us. Do you ever consider that sort of stuff to put in your stories, things that we're dealing with in society that people can relate to?
Yeah, I mean, listen, I think you don't get into making movies, at least I didn't get into making movies just to kind of make frivolous entertainment at every turn. Although 21 Bridges, very entertaining, don't worry. But I mean, it also comments on what's going on, you know? And I think... Any artist, any writer kind of in this room tonight is thinking about the world and all the shit happening in it, and how do I reflect that? How can I comment on it, start to change it? You know, I think one of the great things about movies is you go into a dark place on a big screen and you watch something happen that maybe can't happen in real life, but... can plant a kernel of that could happen in real life, you know? Maybe the President of the United States could be African American. Hollywood was doing that a lot longer than we were actually doing that in real life.
A sort of reality you can imagine, right?
Yeah, maybe we don't have to burn coal anymore, you know? Like, whatever that is that you think can't possibly happen in real life can happen in a movie in 5 seconds. And it gives you the seed of, well, fuck, it happened there. Like, why can't it happen here?
I kind of wanted to end off with, you've seen the side of the acting side, the performance side, the writer's side, being in the industry on the lows and ups, you've rolled the wave and the roller coaster.
Sure.
In that sense. How do you kind of get away from it all in a sense in your life? Do you have any certain hobbies? Because, being sometimes in it, you need to get away from it mentally, because this industry can just bring you down when the times are rough and that. What are some things that keep you grounded that you like to do as like hobbies to get away from it all, to decompress?
Yeah, I mean, it sounds cliche, but I mean, I have a great family, and I really use them as a support network. No one is in the business, so they just sort of, it's cool to them, but they are also like, cool, can you just like go fishing with your nephew or something? Like no one really cares, and in a great way. I think also it's super important to not have this be the only thing that matters to you in the world, because it can't, 1 minute you're gonna have your movie poster 700 feet on the corner of Sunset and Vine. I'm gonna wake up in 2 weeks, be in my underwear, and have to write the next thing, And you have to know that that's coming. And listen, this is brand new for me, so it's very exciting, and I'm trying to figure out, this is an awesome thing. I'm flying to New York City next week for a big premiere, and that's going to be an amazing time. And how do I just enjoy that, but also get ready to do the next thing and keep working? And I think you gotta. I don't have an answer for it yet, but you gotta kind of keep working. Yeah.
You know that there's reality. And enjoying the moment, the glamour, and all the, kind of the appreciation of your work, too, that you put in, it's being recognized, but then, knowing that that doesn't last forever, too, that you need to work on it constantly, that it doesn't, it's not a one-time thing, and I think you have a good mindset, seeing the lower side, and now, the benefits of your work, to know that, you just kind of got to keep on grinding in a way.
Yeah, thank you, man. Yeah, I think, if anything, I'm grateful for those lower times when things weren't working. It does give me a perspective of these high times are great, but it can, it's a short road from the penthouse to the outhouse, as they say. And
both ways, one day you can be from the bottom to the top and then backwards. So.
Yeah, in a way you have to commit yourself to the work. And that's it. And enjoy the red carpet, enjoy the big poster, and then wake up tomorrow morning. I'm going to have 2 whiskeys, wake up tomorrow morning, and do it again and write again.
There you go.
And that's what you got to do.
Love it.
Yeah.
Really,
hey, man.
I'm so happy.
Thank you so much.
For you.
Thank you.
And, what's going on. I'm awesome. Super excited about seeing your work.
Thank you, man. Thank you.
So,
it's been a wild ride.